Americans knew only from the classics they had to read in school. The England of the towns and cities, whose people have defended their island's freedom for over 1,000 years. But today, their countryside has changed. Today, their island has been converted into a gigantic bomber field, a super aircraft carrier anchored off the shores of Fortress Europe, with hangars and machine shops, with hundreds of dispersal points, perimeter tracks, and concrete runways. This is England in its 5th year of war. And this is the new battlefront, the air front, from which we seek out the enemy. Not his infantry or his artillery, not his panzer divisions, but the greater menace, the industrial heart of his nation, the foundation on which the Nazi Empire and its armies stand, the power behind the German lust for conquest. The steel mills and refineries, shipyards and submarine pens, factories and munitions plants, pinpoints on the map of Europe which mean rubber, guns, ball bearings, shells, engines, planes, tanks, targets. Targets to be destroyed. And these are the destroyers, each with a belly full of bombs, and 10 men, like the crew of the Memphis Belle. Pilot, Captain Robert Morgan, industrial engineer from Asheville, North Carolina. He's flown this ship across the Atlantic. The other pilot, Captain Jim Varinas, business administration student at the University of Connecticut. Radio operator and gunner, Sergeant Bob Hansen, construction worker from Spokane, Washington. Navigator, Captain Chuck Layton, chemistry student at Ohio Wesleyan. Engineer and top turret gunner, Sergeant Harold Locke, from Green Bay, Wisconsin. Used to be a stevedore. Besides keeping the bell in order, he covers the sky above. Tail gunner, Sergeant John Quinlan of Yonkers, New York. Clerked for a carpet company, but he quit December 8th, 1941. Ball turret gunner, Sergeant Cecil Scott. Pressman for a rubber company in Rahway, New Jersey. Pilot to crew, 10,000, put on oxygen. They're climbing higher now, 300 feet a minute. The strain on the planes and on the men is mounting. The rest of the crew, bombardier Captain Vincent Evans, operated a fleet of trucks in Fort Worth, Texas. Waste gunners, on the right, Sergeant Bill Winchell, chemist for a paint company in Chicago. And on the left, Sergeant Tony Nastal, used to repair washing machines in Detroit when he was a kid. Now he's 19 and has 2 Nazi fighters, confirmed. It takes all of a pilot's strength to keep a 30-ton fortress in tight formation. But the formation is the bomber's best defense against enemy fighters. The planes are deployed to uncover every gun, stepped up and down, echelon to the right and left. Arranged to overcome the danger of gunners firing into friendly ships. Arranged so concentrated cones of fire from the caliber 50 machine guns cover the sky for 1,000 yards in every direction. The friendly coast of England slips by below. It doesn't look like much now, but in a few hours when you come back, if you come back, this will be the most beautiful view in the world. Higher and higher, climbing to reach your best operational altitude, 25,000 feet, 5 miles straight up. So high you can't be seen from the ground with a naked eye. So high that after 1 minute without oxygen, you lose consciousness. After 20 minutes, you're dead. From now to the target, you go about your routine duties, plot your course, check your equipment, and wait, and think. Higher and colder, temperature 40 degrees below zero. Take off your glove and you loosen fingers. You look out at the strange world beyond, reflections in plexiglass, like nothing you ever saw before, outside of a dream. Lifeless stratosphere until until the exhaust of the engines mixing with the cold, thin air condenses and streams the heavens with vapor trails. To the men in the ships, they're far from beautiful, for they point like beckoning fingers to the formation, signposts in the sky for the enemy to spot us. For these bombers to accomplish their mission, a plan is needed. Carefully worked out, timed to the minute. The job is to bomb Wilhelmshaven, effectively and economically. The enemy is strong, skillful, determined to stop us. Here are his defenses. Air drones, well dispersed. Each plane indicates a Staffel, or squadron of fighters. Heavy anti-aircraft, highly trained and accurate, all along the coast and defending his vital installations. Radar to warn him of our coming. Here is our plan to divide his defenses and weaken his opposition. At 13:30 hours, shortly after takeoff, six groups of planes will be heading toward the enemy coast from six directions. The Blue Force, 100 B-24 Liberator four-engine bombers. The White Force, 300 B-17 Flying Fortresses. The Green Force, 300 B-17s with an escort of six squadrons of P-47 Thunderbolts. A force of B-26 Marauders, twin-engine medium bombers with six squadrons of RAF Spitfires escorting. Almost 1,000 planes and over 8,000 men in the air. The enemy alerts all his air drones. But which is our main force? What are our targets? Where should the Nazi controllers send their fighters? It's our job to make them guess and guess wrong. A half hour later at 1400 hours, the Blue Force will be heading east across the North Sea with the White Force following. These enemy fighters are tied down, waiting to meet them, and will not be able to attack the Green Force. These fighters must come up to attack the Green Force, and thus will be no threat to the Blue and White Forces. The B-26s and Spitfires will bomb and strafe a key rail junction, diverting these six Staffeln and preventing the enemy from concentrating too many fighters on the Green Force, which is scheduled to bomb an aircraft factory at Hanover. At 14:30 hours, the Blue Force will threaten this entire coastal area of northwestern Germany. Which target will it be? Flensburg? The Kiel Canal? Or will it turn suddenly and bomb Hamburg, Vegersack, or Emden? Actually, it carries no bombs at all. It's a decoy and keeps the fighters from the northern area busy while the White Force, the main effort, heads for the submarine pens of Wilhelmshaven. At 1500 hours, while the White Force is over its target, only a fraction of the available German fighter strength of the area can intercept it. Because of the Blue Force diversion and the simultaneous bombing of Hanover by the Green Force. This is the plan of battle for today, drawn up by the Combined Operations Planning Committee and approved by the commanding general. Lead group, low squadron. We've crossed the invisible line of enemy radar. The Hun is expecting us. Steel helmets go on,